Daniela Hirashko Stolz is one of the true pioneers of women's ski jumping. She launched her career with consecutive gold medal performances at the Innsbruck 2005 and Turin 2007 Winter Universiads. Dreams to compete at the Olympic Games were shattered when the IOC denied women's ski jumping into the Vancouver 2010 Games. But the Austrian ski jumper remained hopeful and realized that dream, along with 29 fellow female athletes at the Sochi 2014 Olympic Winter Games. Hirashko Stolz leaped to a silver medal, narrowly missing gold at the much anticipated Olympic debut of her event. Now 7 years after that historic day, she is still soaring among the best in the world. At the recent World Championships in Germany, the 37-year-old veteran ski jumper struck gold alongside three Austrian teammates in the women's team event. So how many more years can Hirashko Stolz keep up this ability and success in women's ski jumping? And will we see her take flight next winter at the Beijing 2022 Olympic Winter Games? Hello and welcome to another edition of the FISU University Legends Interview Series. I'm Brian Pennelly. And joining me now from her home in Austria is the two-time Winter Universiad champion, Daniela Hirashko Stolz. Hello, Daniela, how are you doing today?
Hi, I'm fine. Thanks for inviting me. And thanks for the nice introduction.
Well, thank you for joining us. I know your season just ended this past weekend in Russia. Obviously, a complicated season with COVID issues, obviously, for all sports. But nevertheless, a good season for you. Fifth place in the overall standings, gold medal with your teammates at the World Championships. Tell me about this last event in Russia and about the whole season this year.
The whole season was really okay, was good, because now ski jumping gets a little bit not so easy as it was 20 years ago. So I have to do a lot of technical training. It's a little bit another technique. And so I tried really hard and make some really good steps in the right direction. But focus is for me is next year. I see that season that I really could compete with the top woman in the world. And I was always close to the podium. But looking forward for next year. Russia was a really good trip because it was funny because I think everyone else has to rule the COVID rules, but not the Russians. So it's really, it's different. But this year for me, it was really fun because I can do my sport and you have a privileged if you're a sportsman because you can travel around, you can train and doing stuff like that. And it is really a rough time for the whole world. And if you are good in sports, it's not so rough.
Daniela, let's go back to 2005 there in Innsbruck, where obviously the 1964, the 1976 Winter Olympics were. And there you are as a young student athlete competing at your first Winter Universiad in your home country, at really a mecca for winter sports. You won the gold medal there at the famed Olympic Stadium that we've seen so many photos of over the years. Looking back to those times, how important was that for your career? How exciting was that moment and that time in Innsbruck?
It was really exciting event because I just graduated with school 2004 in Stams. And then I decided in the summer to went to Innsbruck to live there. And I started playing soccer in Innsbruck. And next to it, I tried a little bit to study. I think I first tried with education studies of my second study. And it was really close with the first student Olympic Games because I finished school just before in the summer. And it was the old hill in Seefeld. Now it's the new hill. I like it much more now.
And nevertheless, the atmosphere in Austria, being at home, I assume around family and friends and, just the whole Winter Universiad experience. What was that like?
Yeah, it was really great experience because it was there are a lot of Austrian good ski jumpers competing in Austria, of course. And so it was a lot of pressure because everyone wants me to make the gold medal. And if I make silver medal, it won't be right. And so it was a lot of pressure. And for me, it was really fun if I celebrate the medal, because I started finding new friends. I had a whole football team who comes visiting me in Seefeld. Also, my family was there. It's far away from my hometown. It's about, 5 hours driving, but it's not so close to Eisenach, where I come from. But they also were there. And Seefeld is maybe a good place for me. Also, the World Championship last year with three medals is pretty cool. So it's one of my favorite sport places, and it's really wonderful.
Good times in Austria. So your Winter Universiade experience, though, wasn't done there. You continued with it 2 years later in Turin, Italy, 2007, which was actually the home of the first Winter Universiade back in 1959. And of course, this was also 1 year after the Olympic Winter Games were there in Turin. So another iconic venue. How did that gold medal compare to the first one?
It was easier for me, I guess, because I jumped pretty good at that time, and also the hill. I really loved that hill in Turin. It was my first time there. Also, the normal Olympic Games where women are not allowed to compete there. And so I enjoyed the time, and it was great because in Seefeld, we all stay at home and just travel to the competition. And in Turin, the whole Austrian team had a hotel and physio and doctors and trainers, and also the people from the International Olympic Committee and the National Olympic Committee were there. And so you meet a lot of other sportsmen and women. And it was, for me, it was, if student Olympic Games, it was more Olympic spirit than in Seefeld, because I just went to the competition and went home again and nothing else. But there you live like an Olympic athlete. I enjoyed this experience, of course, much more, because all the other athletes, and you can celebrate and with the others, and it was really fun, yes.
What would you say, I should say, at the time you were also pursuing studies in education, and, you know, obviously this was back before our online movement where we join anybody and everybody any time of the day. So, much more difficult. But at the time, how tricky was it for you to juggle studies with competitive ski jumping?
It was really, really tricky because I decided for me, it was sure I'm not really here and I can't study in the winter time. So I need something to study where I can miss many days or fail many days. And so that's why I tried education studies, but it was not like ski jumping, because if I'm like, hey, come training, I will go. So everybody says, come to the university. I said, oh. So it was really hard, and but I enjoyed it there. It was really great, and I learned a lot for the life. Also, women rights was in it, and maybe it helps me later when I try to be a coach. It really will help me in my life. But for me, the hardest thing is what I had no money, and I live alone in Innsbruck, and I have to, I don't know, a flat with a few or five people I didn't know. And so I tried to find something new, and I always have to call my parents to send me some money at the end of the month. And so that's why I decided, because I had to go work and quit studying, because ski jumping was not a good sport for earning money at that time.
That leads perfectly to my next question. And, you know, I guess you relish those experiences back then more now after the success that you've had. But what were those early days like for women ski jumping, right? You were fighting with, you know, to try to get into the 2010 Vancouver Olympics, and we'll get to more about that. But what was it like? And, you know, you were coming up with my friend for many years, Lindsay Van, in Park City, Utah. Maybe you had similar careers promoting the sport and, you know, just trying to make progress. What were those early days like? Maybe you didn't get enough respect.
Lindsay and I, we were a little bit a dream team. We met us, we were both pretty young. I think it was about 1999 or something like that, and yeah, it's a long time ago, and I think we were 15 years old, and we are allowed to jump at the Holmenkollen, and we had so much fun there with hitchhiking and something else. We were a little bit crazy, but maybe you have to be crazy like that as a kid, and so also email was possible at that time. It's not so long ago, and then now I have a stay in contact with Lindsay. She always called me and said, "Go, Danny, kick some asses." She follow my career, and yeah, it's really good. And our family, was a woman ski jumping was not at the Olympic Games, or there were no world championships, or even no World Cup. Was more a family, because we all have to struggle for the same for the rights, and we have to fight to get more competitions, to get better competitions, to get money, to I don't know the standing in the National Ski Federation or what else. So we are more like a family, because we have all the big same goal, get women ski jumping to the Olympic Games.
So finally, in 2014, the dream is realized in Sochi. Women's ski jumping finally makes its Olympic debut after striving for it for many years. And obviously it went well for you. I know you were fifth after the first jump. Won a silver medal with an astounding second jump, I believe 104.5 meters, which was an Olympic record. Karina Vogt of Germany ultimately came down and narrowly defeated you for gold by 1.2 points. What was that whole experience in Sochi like, not only for you and the silver medal, but also for the movement of women's ski jumping?
It was really, really great, because it was I was the only survivor, because every other Lindsay quit just a few years before. Annette Sagen from Norway, she was not good enough to get to the Olympic, and I think we three did so much for women's ski jumping, and they always called me, and I was from the older people who fighting for Vancouver, or just before fighting for World Cup and for World Championships and things like that. I was the only one who can make a medal. And so it was, yeah, it was a lot of pressure, because I jumped pretty good in the training. And yeah, after the first round, I was fifth, and I really didn't have such a good jump. The second jump was awesome. Landing was not so nice, but Karina Vogt, she really jumped pretty good there. And so it's a silver medal, and I'm so happy with the silver medal.
But now here in 2021, women's sport has really come a long way, it seems. I want to get your opinion over the 20 years that you've been competing. Actually, how far would you say, Daniela, women's sport and gender equality in sport in general has come over these past two decades, and especially, you know, more recently?
I think we make a lot of steps the last 20 years, but as an athlete, it will be always too slow. But if you see the time, there are really good points we arrived. It's not similar to the men, but it's really good. If we look at this year, at the World Championships in Oberstdorf, we have four competitions, same as the boys. There is different in the prize money, of course, but that depends about media, about TV, and about anything else. And I know we make the same job and didn't earn the same money, but that will take another time, and we have to try to do something for that.
Very admirable for all your perseverance and you know, everything that you and your fellow women ski jumpers and many female athletes have been through. So just kind of wrapping up here, Danielle, I know you probably, you know, want to get back to training, or maybe you're enjoying your rest, but the Beijing 2022 Olympics are you know, just about 10 months away. There's still a lot of uncertainty, obviously, with our global health situation. But how important of a goal is it for you to compete at a third Olympic Winter Games following Sochi and Pyeongchang?
Of course, I want to go to Beijing. I've never been in China, so it will be another cool experience I can make. And also my body shape is much better than it was in the past 5 years, because I had a lot of injuries and a lot of operation, especially about 9 knee operations. And so it took me some time to get me back into a good shape. And now the last 2 years, I feel pretty strong as a my body condition. But now I have to work more technically at ski jumping. And yeah, it will be close. But I see that here I get fifth in the overall. So I'm close to the top level. And yeah, it's still fun. And so I will compete.
All right, Daniela, we'll keep at it. Hope to see you in Beijing. Congratulations on an amazing career. And thanks for taking the time to reminisce about your days at the Winter Universiads with FISU. I hope that was enjoyable for you to look back at those memorable times.
Yeah, I have it. The medal is still next to me. It's here. Maybe you can
we let us see it? This is from Innsbruck.
No, this is Sochi.
Oh, I'm Sochi. Fantastic. The silver medal. Beautiful.
Yes, it's World Championships medals.
Nice.
That's the overall snow.
Wow. 2013, right?
I have too many now. And also, my woman, I'm just allowed to have just this.
Unbelievable. What an amazing collection, Daniela. Thanks again. Enjoy some time off now that the season is over, and we look forward to seeing you and your fellow women ski jumpers there in Beijing.
Thank you.
All right.
Are you coming to Beijing as well?
I hope so. I believe so. Let's see how things shape up. And thanks to you for joining us on this edition of the FISU University Legends interview series. Be sure to stay tuned for future editions where we learn about athletes' career that were all started there at Winter and Summer Universiads and have gone on to prosperous careers. Have a nice day, everybody.